concept of jati or dharma in different planes. We are looking towards the mantras with fixated ideas of varnashrama dharma that we have in our mind. While Gita Mata is trying to talk about the varnashrama dharma in the way it actually existed. The conflict between our understanding and what is being propounded is a direct reflection of the notions that are being carried by us for a longer period of time. The scheme of thing for Bhagavad Gita is very clear. Correctly imbibing the spirit of Sankhya philosophy into the scripture, Gita Mata has told one thing to us, that all you can do is, in this game that is played by 8 different players, the whole game plan is Ashtada Prakruti. You have Pancha Mahabhuta, the objects to play with, and you have 3 instruments to play with those objects. Those are 3 gunas. So Triguna and Pancha Mahabhuta, your game is over. It is all the Ashtada Prakruti, that is your field and periphery. Beyond that you cannot go. And if you succeed in transcending that, then you did not play the game at all. So it becomes imperative that first of all I understand what the game plan is, so that, as Gurudev emphasizes that word, that there is a strategy played by Ashtada Prakruti, and we must plan what is called anti-strategy. This is Gurudeva's word. What it means is a proper understanding of me and my surroundings in an intellectually dissecting way is the first step towards knowing the whole game plan in entirety. If I become the part of this game plan and carry on as if I'm one of the player of this game plan, then you shall be condemned to remain the player forever in the life. Or else you have a choice to abdicate the game plan and come out of it, because you are the ruler of the game plan. You are the Ishvara, you are the Ishitva of that game plan. And for that, Bhagavad Gita starts telling that first try to identify how the game is played, and instead of Pancha Mahabhuta, the emphasis more on the Trigunas, because Pancha Mahabhuta is none of your business. It is God's business. You cannot do anything to Pancha Mahabhutas. They were there, they will be there, they are there. What can change, or what has been given to you to change, are the Trigunas. Now, before I change myself, I must know what am I embodied with, which guna has predominated in me. If a particular guna has predominated in me, then the logical corollary is, why is it so that I am not a Brahmana in true sense by birth, not the Brahmana, Purohita Brahmana as we call them. Swami Ranganathananda, while commenting on Bhagavad Gita, has beautifully said that Brahmanatva is what is commented in Bhagavad Gita, not Brahmana, the way we have connotation about. Not only that, Buddha Deva in Buddhism, in Abhidhamma Pitika, one of the what can be termed as Upanishadas of Buddhism is Abhidhamma Pitika. In that there is a special chapter called Brahmana Vaggo, where Buddha Deva himself has given umpteen number of shlokas describing how he respects a Brahmana, the person apparently who is against the Vedas, who does not respect the Vedas. That is what we feel, that is what have we been told about, is talking about a Brahmana, and it is there in the scriptures most interior aspect. What it means is, the Lord Buddha Deva, the way he understood the Varnashrama, Gita Mata, the way she wants to connote it, and the way we interpret it, there is a vast difference in it. The predominance of guna in a particular individual is not a matter of yesterday. It is a matter of preponderance that has been happening with the jiva over a period of time, and time here means number of multiple births. I develop what is called in English a propensity to do something. A propensity comes by virtue of my way of reacting to the interaction with the world. That's why Swamiji correctly said, it is how the individual interacts with the world. The first interaction might have happened a couple of births back. I developed a particular set of reaction to that. Based on that, my gunas have started predominating me, and I have reached to this point in my journey now with my yesteryear's treasure of a particular guna or mix of these gunas in a particular percentage. The table was beautifully given by Gurudeva. So if I am 90% predominated by tamas, I don't have to go to any laboratory to find out. My very tendency to be moving away from anything that is good, anything that is eulogized in scriptures, means I am dominated by tamas. I do everything that my sense organ intend me to do and I just fall flat for them is dominance of tamas. If the sense organs are dominating my thought process, and even when the object is not around, my memories are bringing back all those bad things that I have done in the past, which I am inclined to do in the present, and I truly like them being done, that means the tamas is predominating in me. And then the question comes that who is the, or what is the first awareness that can come to somebody? And the first step of awareness is to know that something is wrong. Something has gone wrong with me is the first dawn of light that comes to us. And a person to whom such a dawn of light has come, he suddenly realizes that there is so much of wrong things that are happening around me. He starts feeling belittled about it, start feeling a sense of surrender to God, and the first thought comes that, oh my Lord, I intend to do something better, but I am not equipped with anything. That first awareness where I am completely dejected because of my wrongdoings, because of the sorrow that I am getting, when such a sorrow flows, yat such shuchihi dravati, I am a shudraha. So it is the first step of awareness, and in that state what can you do? Scripture samajh mein nahi aati, rajas hai nahi. What is left for me is to make the best of the current situation, and the current situation only tells me that find out where the goodness lies and try to go towards it. So imagining somebody, a group of four people trying to do an ascent to a mountain, the first thing is to identify the mountain, which one to scale. And that process of identification, and the intellect, if it is restricted only at that level, the Shudra comes into the picture. After the mountain has been identified, the most important part is to identify which way to opt for. Because some of the ways are going to bring me down back again from the mountain to the jungles. So I must identify the right and the wrong of doing the spiritual ascent. And the process of doing that is choosing between the right and wrong and collecting the right as an asset with the yan labhase nija karmo upate vittam tenam vinodaya chittam. My asset is what my good thoughts are, because with the help of that I'll be able to distinguish or discriminate. It is called udaya of viveka. This the vaishya does diligently. Once he discriminates diligently, he knows what to opt for, what not to opt for. Loss I cannot be opting for, profit I must opt for. So the eye on the spiritual profit is sadguna assets, continuous influx of sadguna, having abundance wealth of sadguna. The vaishya becomes equipped now to interact with the panchamahabhautik vishwa, and then while interacting, there shall be enormous enemies around, which will be in the form of yashakirti satta sampatti pratishtha, which will be in the form of kama, krodha, madamoha, lobha, matsara, And when these come in front of me, they stop me from doing the final ascent, and I must be now prepared to annihilate them with the help of my sword, which is intellectual sword of mine. Jatan poochiye sadhu ki, pooch lijiye gyan, mol karo talwar ka padi rahen do mian. It doesn't matter who you are, it matters what kind of instrument you have to slaughter the enemies of spiritual ascent. One who does that, kshata trayati iti kshatriya, there is a kshati that is likely to happen. You might be annihilated by the enemies, but before that, by virtue of the instrument that you have. These instruments are obtained by you because of a guna called rajasa. So tamasa predominated slowly with rajasa, bringing kshudra into the vaishya fold. The vaishya fold slowly jettisoning the tamasa completely and dominating rajasa with the advent of sattvikta into it. Raja Janaka, Raja Shivaji, Maharana Pratap. There was enormous amount of rajas in them. Rajas predominated with a beautiful tinge of sattvikta into it. So when it came to a kshatriya, what he does is nothing else but annihilating every single enemy that shall stop him from doing the final spiritual ascent, where none of these instruments are of any use. A special kind of instruments are required in the final ascent, which only the Brahmana has, which have been earlier described as the 9 important criteria. Is it a duty or is it a quality? A duty is bound by virtue of the guna that predominates. You shall do that, thy shall do that, because you are predominated with the rajasa. So then it becomes a duty. If I am a born kshatriya, not by virtue of my surname, but by virtue of my predominance of rajasa in me, it happened with Raja Shivaji. Swami Vivekananda has called him Shiva Swarupa. When Raja Shivaji went to Sri Shailam in Andhra Pradesh, he went for darshan. He was on his Kshatriya war along with the Qutub Shah of Golconda on the southern side. On the way, he went to take darshan of Sri Shailam. While taking darshan, he was overwhelmed by the emotion, sattvikata, and immediately spoke to his immediate colleague saying that, I feel like laying down the arms now and I want to become a sannyasi. And the advice given was very simple. The same advice that we see for Partha was same advice was given to Shivaji by his immediate confidant. And it was told, Samartha Ramdas told him, your role is as a kshatriya. Your swadharma is a kshatriya. And not only that, it is your predominance of rajasa that will make you fight. You, whatever you may do, you will ultimately remain a kshatriya. Today, if you go for begging the arms, and if the arms do not come to you, you will remain hungry. Why? Because your kshatriyata will not allow you to accept a no from somebody. That is the dominance, and then he came back into the fold. When such the qualities that are described, when they are viewed as a duty, automatically it becomes a quality. You imbibe them as qualities, you perform them as duties. And then when these two things are done, then the mantra talks about the qualities that they have. A greater dose of Rajaguna. Swamiji has not said that it is only Rajaguna. Greater dose. Greater dose would mean a preponderance. They do have enormous sattvikta with them. It's not that it is not there. But what predominates is being the leader. On a secular level, they are the leaders of the society. On the philosophical level, they are imbibed or imbued with Rajoguna. So both the things are simultaneously meet. And then on one hand, on a secular level, he turns out to be the best Raja in terms of his functioning. But on a personal level as a Kshatriya, he has to have all these gunas. And the gunas are described, Swamiji says, the 4 castes are described in terms of their manifested individuality in the Gita. Why in the Gita? Because if we start reading Smritis, if we start reading some of these Manusmriti and other Smritis, one may get veiled about the interpretation of, and this veiling is not an impossible thing. Few of the most enlightened thinkers of our land, Dr. Baba Saheb Ambedkar, enormous amount of intellect that he had, interpretations differed. The interpretation of Chaturvarnya and his concept, the way he understood, differed, amounted to a kind of a rebellion amongst the masses. We are not into the political side of it. What we are trying to say, that a person of enormous intellect or might get waylaid. And then what is the way out? The way out is Mahajano Yena Gataha Sapantaha. Do not employ our brain. That is why Swamiji says, in Gita. In Gita means that is our final frontier. If that is the final frontier, then the gunas have been described, the duties have been described. Prowess and boldness, shauryam and tejaha. Shaurya, courage or valor. Valor is a part of kshatriya where, and this is especially one who is in this world, every single thing that happens around need not be conducive to us. And immediately some call, some message, some news disturbs us. A news as distant as government is in trouble, place is in recession. Where is the kshatriyata? Gone. Why should anybody around, any situation around, disturb me? I shall remain. And that is why Rana Pratap is the only ruler in the medieval India who did not have an inch of land. While the person with whom he fought, who happens to be again his own crow brother, Raja Manasingh, is supposed to have the bars of gold in his palace. The Raja of Gogunda, Rana Pratap, had no inch of land. He ate, sometimes they say, eat grass also. But what is important is the preponderance of Rajas in him. While the duty of that Rajastha with Raja Mansingh was not up to the mark. So that is why, irrespective of any situation, Rana Pratap was never moved. 3-4 powerful enemies for a son of a farmer, having a small jagir near Pune, was not affected. He was offered the subedari of entire South India, Dakkan Subeda, but he said no to that. Why? I am a Hindu. A Raja is Shaurya Pravrutta. And then comes Tej. Tej, the word used by Shankaracharya for Tej is Pragalbhata. Tej. When sun rises, is it possible that anyone can deter him? Any kind of, any amount of Tej coming in front of sun is subdued by sun himself. So when a Kshatriya stands, there is no one or nothing that can happen around which will snub him, because his own valor is up to that extent. Then the second quality that comes is Dhruti. Dhruti dharanam sarva avasthasu anavasado bhavati. This is what Shankaracharya said. Anavasada, no way, no question. Any situation, anavasada, not possible. Not cowed down by anything. Swamiji rightly says, he says, having decided to do something, he shall pursue the path till the end. Either I remain alive or else what I have decided will be done. When Shivaji was called to meet Aurangzeb in Agra, it was sure almost that he would be killed there, because he was entering into enemy territory with hardly few people with him, and for the Patshah of Delhi, of Agra. And incidentally, the whole court was dominated by enemies of Shivaji. One of the enemy was his own brother-in-law, Shahista Khan, whose fingers were chopped by Shivaji. So Aurangzeb's sister was every day telling him, kill him. He was arrested, kill him. The only reason was kept alive because there was a word given by a Rajput, Mirza Raja Jai Singh. His own son Ram Singh was given as a boy to stay with him, as a young boy prince. Now in these all situations, while living for this particular vision, he bowed in front of his mother, went to Bhavani Devi, put his Bhavani sword there, and he said, it's not a question of my death. I shall go to Agra. But Devi, don't spare me. Spare the principle for which you have made me fight. That is how the concept of Dhruti comes into the picture. Moving forward, another thing is promptitude or daksham. In fact, it is correctly said by Samartha Ramadas, Savada or Daksh, use tatkala moksha. Dakshata is ever alertness. Our own example is enough to talk about this. Moment we sthala kala tyag, moment we leave this place, everything tempts us around. Why? We are not alert. What I am doing shall put me down spiritually comes to us only after the things have happened. Oh my God, what did I do? The Friday went off without reading anything. Next Friday I shall do it now. This is where Dakshata remains absent. And that is why sahasa pratyutpanneshu karyeshu avya mohena pravruttihi iti. This is how Shankaracharya has described it. Not fleeing from battle, apalayanam, aparanmukhi bhava shatrubhya. Palayanam, and Swami just beautifully, it's little elaborated it here, and there is a reason for it. Stupidly fighting when you are not supposed to fight is not a palayanam. Swami just specifically said, a tactical retreat. In 1970, when war, a question was asked by Indira Gandhi to General Sam Monekshaw. And having personally met him, I have a fortune of meeting him in person. A born Kshatriya, I would say, he may be a Parsi to everybody, but from Gita Mata scripture point of view, he was a born Kshatriya. When he was asked by Indira Gandhi that we need to attack Bangladesh or the then East Pakistan, a prompt answer was, we shall be defeated. And she said, how a commander in chief can talk like this? He said, no. But she said, I want to win this battle. He said, give me 6 months. And then what will happen? Then I will win the battle. It took 6 months for his war preparedness. That is what gave the largest surrender of any army in post-Second World War era till date. That happened was because of this. And that all happened because of this particular prompt. He was daksha when he attacked. He was not so, so he took his own time. Promptitude is being alert every now and then, whenever required, and then not fleeing from the battle, but taking a tactical retreat. Coming to the generosity or danam, deshu muktahastanam. First of all, what is to be given should be understood by a kshatriya. What will you give? What you have. A person is barely meeting his both ends and he wants to do danam. You cannot. You don't have it. No, but I require this much and God has given me this much. Sadhu itna dijiye jame kutumb samaye. Mai bhi bhuka na rahu sadhu na bhuka jaye. That is what Kabir Maharaj says. And how much is my requirement? As much as I decide. Having two legs as a beautiful vehicle is enough a requirement, but having two BMWs also is short for some people. So one needs to decide that once you have it, then mukteshu. Maine diya, maine upkar kiya, Chinmay Mission ne kaam kiya tha, usme maine 5000 rupaye diya. Matlab ye Raja Harshavardhan ke baad inhi ka number hai. First of all, Swami Vivekananda, when he was doing a plague relief work, what happened is they had just collected some money to build Ramakrishna's memorial. As it is, they were all monks. How much they would have collected? A very little amount by begging or whatever. All of a sudden, the plague came. The first thing Swamiji said is, distribute it and help everybody who is suffering from plague. Two or three disciples said, Swamiji, but what about Ramakrishna gaya baad mein dekha jayega. What he meant was, when you have it. So immediately one Marwadi joined in that and he gave a lot of money. And then when the relief camp was there, he came and told Swamiji, Swamiji, what should I tell you? I'm feeling so rewarded that my money came to use. And Swamiji blasted him left, right, said, whose money? Whose money have you given? You have not given the money. They gave you an opportunity to serve them. So thank them. To get that money from you was already in their prarabdha. Who are you to give? So when it comes to you, it is not yours. Give it where it is expected to do. A postman cannot conceal a money order in his home. He is supposed to deliver it. That is where danam comes. And that is why Maharaja of Khetri, one who helped wholeheartedly Swami Vivekananda, is in the today Amar. And many other kings, we do not remember them. So such a Kshatriya then comes to Ishwara Bhava. Prabhu Shakti Prakatikaranam. This is how Shankaracharya has described this quality. Sometimes we feel that how can a Kshatriya become suddenly Ishwara? It is not possible to become Ishwara, but we can manifest the aspect of Ishwara in us by showing it. Ishitva. Ishitva is when you tend to somebody like a mother. So Ishwara Bhava is a part and parcel of that particular, the crown, the robe and the throne have a knack of electing for themselves the true warrior. Ishitva Bhava. And that is why a Kshatriya should be doing Danam. The present place where we are staying. What is the problem with the king? Raja Vyapari, Praja Bhikari. That is what the Kahavat is. When Kshatriyata is left and he himself becomes a trader, then what happens to the community? If you happen to read the history of Vijayanagar Empire, we will see the same situation. After Krishnadevaraya, Ramadevaraya came, and during Ramadevaraya's period, the king decided to become a trader. So he started taxing so much, from barbers to the fish. Fishermen while fishing also was taxed. And nothing was in turn given back to the society. The entire empire vanished. Why? Kshatriya had taken the role of Vaishya. And that is how, when it comes to the Vaishyas and Shudras, it says, Krushi Gauraksha Vanijyam Vaishya Karma Swabhavajam. This is where you have been asked to accumulate the width for the sake of the society. That is why even today in our community, some of the richest communities, which are the trading communities, if you look at their danam, it is enormous. Take the example of Birlas, take the example of so many people, hospitals, charities, everything they do, that is because, one, when there was no capacity to earn anything and learn anything, the Shudra has graduated to Vaishya now, so he has started discriminating, accumulating and sustaining the society through, by virtue of the distribution of the wealth that he has. And then once he comes to that, the Rajasic mind cannot fly into meditation and maintain its poise as easily, as beautifully as Sattvic mind can. The whole process, as we can see, is nothing else but graduating from Tamasikata to Sattvikata. Three ladders to pass from one to the third, and then to throw the ladder altogether once we get up to the top. After reaching the pinnacle, after reaching Mount Everest, what is the use of having any instrument? You have reached the goal. Nistraigunyodhuva Arjuna. You are supposed to be at that stage. No, but I would like to do that tomorrow itself. That is not possible. The evolution that the Sankhyas talk about is this evolution. Vivekananda has commented a lot on that. And that is where, when it comes to paricharyatmakam karma, what is paricharyatmakam? Aapka paricharya ka kya sadhan hai? We ask everybody. What is that you do for your eating or your living? That is called paricharya in common parlance. Paricharya, one who paricharati iti paricharya. Pari means one who keeps moving all around. Means what? One who requires sustenance every day, he keeps on working every day on daily basis. What means? It is the most downtrodden section of the society. Because of the past karmas, constantly they are in the struggle for survival. All the beggars. The struggle for survival. There is no question of thought of reading Gita can come to the mind, because the next immediate problem is how to feed the child. So when that kind of thing is happening, when such a paricharya is happening, then seva is the only thing that you can do. Because for seva, you do not need any kind of education of any kind. Now you are not contemplating about what are the different ways of shadarshanas. Not required. So only thing, one of the disciple of Ramakrishna, his name was Adbhutananda, never read a single line, never read any scripture, could not write single thing. Swami Vivekananda tried to teach him how to write, he could not write it. To the extent that he even could not call Narendra as Naren used to call Loren. He came from Bihar. He was basically a household boy, working, completely uneducated, but became a Jivan Mukta. And that is why Swami Vivekananda used to say that his name is Adbhutananda. It is an Adbhut thing that how such a person can graduate. But he did it only because his swabhava, his paricharya, his complete sharanagati and seva. So when he was asked about what is sadhana that you did, because future disciples of Vivekananda asked, because he was still alive. So he said that I don't understand what all you people did. All I know is in this world there is only one person called Ramakrishna. All I know is you can breathe Ramakrishna. You can eat Ramakrishna, you can sleep with Ramakrishna, only on the service itself. That is why paricharyatmaka karmam shudrasya api. And then dedication and service is in the spirit of dedication and service, Swamiji. Sushrushvasvabhavam. That is why it is important, Swamiji says, when a person works devotedly in the proper field and the environment best suited to him, he will be exhausting all the vasanas. Golden statement. After all, identifying all this, who you are, is for what purpose? To jettison the vasanas. I have already come to that place because of the vasana. Somewhere I felt I must be ruling. Somewhere I felt I must have more money. Somewhere I felt sensuous pleasure should be all mine. That is what has propelled me into this particular thing. Now the question is not to grow them further. Bhog me yoga jataye so guru satya kahave. Bhog chal raha hai, andar yog ho raha hai. Do all the duties diligently as much as you are supposed to do, but none of them should stick to us. That is where yoga karmasu kaushalyam part comes. It's a beautiful analogy Vita Mata has given. It identifies which varna you are. It has nothing to do with our surname. It has nothing to do with the place you are born. It has nothing to do with bade baap ka beta. It has nothing to do with here which ke kam ko kulat pannaha. Nothing to do with that. How much freedom is given to us? You can be what you are, provided you diagnose yourself, take the proper treatment required, and be spiritually healthy. Hari Om.
Hari Om.